you handle roughly 20% of the websites that are out there on the internet. But you're now quite concerned about the evolution of the internet, and especially the business model that's been kind of underlying the internet so far. Tell us about your concerns.
Sure, and I guess my technology failed, so I'm going with that.
Right.
I don't get to meet Donna today. So this really started about 3 years ago when we started getting calls from media companies that said, there's a new threat. And usually when customers call us and say there's a new threat, it's because there's a new nation state actor, there's a new botnet, there's a new vulnerability that's online. So I said, what's the threat? And media company after media company after media company kept saying, it's AI. And I have to confess that I rolled my eyes and was like, media companies, they're such Luddites. They're always worried about kind of the next technology. But they asked us, they said, just pull the data, just look at what has changed in our business. And so we did. We have very reliable data going back 10 plus years that shows what is happening. We looked at Google as a litmus test. And the business model of Google is they provide a search engine, obviously. When you do a search on Google, it provides you back 10 links. The search is not over at that point. Your job is then to follow that treasure map, go out across the rest of the internet, find whatever it was that you were looking for. And the way that Google works is they make a copy of all of the internet, all the content, and then in exchange for the right to make that copy, they then send traffic back, which then media companies can monetize through subscriptions or advertising or other ways. And 10 years ago, for every 2 pages that Google scraped, they sent you 1 visitor. Mm. Over that period of time, Google has transformed, and we've all watched it, where they've gone from being a search engine, where they give you 10 blue links, to being something closer to what I would call an answer engine, where we've all seen at the top of a Google result now, there's an AI overview that kind of gives you a result. If you search for when was Cloudflare founded, it will tell you right there on the page. You don't have to click on anything else. It's zero-click search. Mm. That's the transition from search engines to answer engines. And at that same time, what Google has transitioned to is, instead of it being 2 pages scraped to 1 visitor, now it's 19-1. Mm-hmm. So it's gotten almost 10 times harder to be a publisher, a media company today. And that's the good news. If you look at ChatGPT, it's 1,500-1. They take 1,500 pages for every 1 visitor they send you. If you look at Anthropic, it's 40,000-1. And the problem is that if we don't have incentives for media companies to generate content, or content creators to generate content, they're gonna stop generating content. But it doesn't stop with that. As we shift to answer engines, it's gonna impact almost all of our businesses. In a world of agentic commerce, what's a brand? Like, what does that mean? Right now, that's a shortcut for humans to be able to judge quality. What does it mean for an agent that's out there? What happens to every small business in the world when I want to buy eggs? I say to my agent, hey, go buy me eggs. They're not going to walk down to the bodega down the street. Right. So I think that this has profound impacts on what the entire internet is going to be. And what people weren't recognizing is that this is a shift in the platform of how people consume information. The same way that we went from the web on your laptop to social to mobile, moving to AI is changing the way that we're going to consume information. It's going to fundamentally change the business model of the internet. And as we think about our mission of how do we help build a better internet, it just seemed natural that we should be thinking about how can we help figure out what that future business model looks like.
I want to ask about a couple of things that you've done to try to address that. But before we get into that, I wanted to ask the context question. Why is this your fight?
Yeah.
I mean, you are not just CEO of Cloudflare. You are owner of a newspaper in Utah. But I think that's a relatively minor part of your interest.
I mean, we believe. So I was the editor of my college newspaper. I believe local news is incredibly important. I think that the work that journalists do is critical, and we should support them. I also think there's a lot that's broken with the media landscape today, where Google has trained us to believe that traffic is a proxy for quality, which it's not. Mm-hmm. We look at a whole bunch of things that are awful. When there's an accident on the freeway, like, we stare at it. That's not because we're good people, right? And traffic doesn't always mean that it's the thing that is advancing human knowledge. In fact, like, you know, you look at like a BuzzFeed or a Huffington Post, like, their business was writing the most salacious headlines with the cheapest possible content. That's not good for humanity. And so there's stuff that's broken about our media world and business model today. It's not that we need to preserve the past, but we do need to think about the future. Why we're in an interesting position is because we're kind of in between it. We don't have a dog directly in the fight. We're not an AI company. We're not a media publisher, but we're this network that sits between them. 80% of the AI companies are our customers. We have great relationships with them. Huge percentage of the internet are our customers. And we're like, these two things need each other. They depend on each other. The fuel that runs these AI engines is original content, which is being generated. And yet at the same time, there's a market failure where, for various reasons, which we can talk about, the AI companies aren't actually compensating those creators for the content that they're creating. And so over time, those content creators are dying. So if we can play a role in helping facilitate that, I think that's a really natural role for us.
Content creators are struggling with many of these trends. They kind of struggled with Google at the beginning. They are now struggling with AI engines in particular. So you've tried a couple of things to kind of help balance the power between some of them. There was Content Independence Day in July. You talked about that. Maybe you could talk a bit about that. But also right now, you're trying to differentiate between what Google is trying to do in AI and what Google is trying to do in search. Why is that important?
So markets need two things to work. You need demand, and then conventionally we say you need supply. That's actually not what you need. What you actually need is limited supply. If you have infinite supply, then there's no market. There's no market for air because there's plenty of it, unless you're scuba diving, and then there's a market for air. The problem with content today is that there's infinite supply. Everyone is giving it away for free. So there needs to be some scarcity in order for a market to exist. And so what we did in cooperation with literally every publisher from the Associated Press to Ziff Davis, it was say, we're going to change the rules starting on July 1st, where if you as an AI company want to get our content, then you need to actually compensate us for that. And that just seems fair, right? And you know, the people who object to that say, you know, I object because you're holding back progress, you're going to slow down AI. And I say, well, if Jensen at NVIDIA charges you for the chips, is he holding back progress? If your AI researchers, who you're paying literally in some cases billions of dollars to, are charging, should we bring back slavery and conscription? Like, this is, progress is so important that no one should get paid in this? Of course that doesn't make sense. The three things that you need to be an AI company are chips, talent, and content. Chips are going to become commodities over time because there's never been a silicon shortage that hasn't turned into a glut. The researchers, the problem with the AI researchers, the reason that there's a shortage is because 5 years ago, if you were in a university studying AI, you were a weirdo, right? It was a hot field in the 70s and 80s that then kind of went in the corner and everyone thought it was dying. That is not the truth anymore. Today, every university student is thinking, how can I get into that hot AI course? Because they see that it's a successful thing. So we're not going to have a massive, you know, glut of AI researchers, but we're certainly not going to have the shortage that we have today. Mm-hmm. And so that actually leaves a lot to be able to compensate creators. But the first step is you have to create scarcity. Mm. Google is a different problem. So Google is, I mean, at some level, the internet owes just an incredible debt to Google. For the last 27 years, Google has been the patron of the internet. They not only invented search, but then they invented all the monetization systems with ads and even subscriptions to be able to take traffic and turn it into revenue. And it aligned with their business model. They wanted more web because that was more things that you had to navigate and be able to search. Mm-hmm. And so they really funded a huge amount of the internet. And as a result, their crawler, the thing that copies the internet down and then create search, has very privileged access to all of the internet today. Mm. Something that no one else does.
Because they're spreading money to all these websites, they get access to that.
And so what Google is doing, which again, I think makes total sense from their perspective, but is incredibly damaging to the market, is Google is saying, we have an absolute God-given right to all of the content in the world, even if we don't pay for it. Because look, what we did for the last 27 years. And they're saying we can take it and use the same crawler we use for search in order to power our AI systems. And if you want to opt out of one, you have to opt out of both. Now, if you're a media company, that's incredibly pernicious. Because if you lose search, you're losing about 20% of your revenue, but it gets even worse. If you block Google's crawler, it blocks their ad safety team, which means that your advertisements across all of your platforms stop working. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which is just a non-starter. And so left this way, if this is the way that the world exists, that Google is able to get content and bundle their crawler together, where OpenAI and Anthropic and Perplexity and everyone else has to be, will be restricted unless they pay. The problem is that we then will have effectively handed the game to Google. Mm-hmm. They get something for free that everyone else has to pay for, and that's not how you have a healthy market.
Now, you're here in London, yeah, not just because you're at the Bloomberg Tech Summit, but
this,
also because...
This, of course, was my top priority.
Of course, of course. But you also wanted to talk with the UK Competition Authority for this very issue. You think that London is actually has a chance to be able to take a leadership role in addressing the very issue that you're talking about.
So every regulator in the world is looking at Google right now. And that actually, there's a big bunch of Google that thinks that the right thing is for them to start paying for content. But they have a bit of a chicken and egg problem, because they don't want to do anything voluntary because they've got so many different regulators that are looking at them. And so the US and Europe are looking at, but the UK has actually been, I think, more thoughtful and a little bit in front of recognizing what the real challenge is. So the CMA here, the Competition Authority, just designated Google as a strategic player in this space. That gives them the ability to then put regulations in place. And what they're trying to think through is, how do we make sure that the market for AI is fair, that there's a level playing field? And I think that's actually a really smart regulation. What we want here is a lot of competition. What we should all be playing for is hundreds of thousands of AI companies buying content from hundreds of thousands of media companies, hundreds of thousands or millions of small businesses, and that you have a really vibrant ecosystem. It is not in anyone's interest for some small set of companies to control what is going to be the interface for information going forward. And so what the CMA is doing right now, I think, is incredibly thoughtful. And what we have suggested is that there's a really simple fix, which is that Google should have to compete for crawl the same way that any other AI company does. And they can continue to use their existing old school Googlebot to do search crawling. But if they want to have any AIs, including the AI overview that appears now is bundled in at the top of search, that they need to use a separate crawler to do that. And that crawler has to start from scratch the same way that OpenAI did, the same way that Anthropic did, the same way that any new entrant does. And that's the only way that you can have a fair market. And I'm really proud that the UK is taking this role.
And what's your take on how they were doing at this point? As you mentioned, they designated them as effectively a monopoly in this space. Do you have a sense of where they're going to come down in this area?
I don't. But again, we have said that we are happy to be of service in any way. We've provided them the data that shows that Google has, with their existing crawler, a unique advantage in the market, which would be very difficult for any other player to be able to replicate. And I think over the next couple of weeks, there are going to be some very important conversations. And what's interesting is that if the UK takes a role in this, I think there's an opportunity that the UK becomes sort of the, and this might not be a very good metaphor here, but sort of the Delaware of content, where in the United States, okay, Delaware created the laws that where everyone registered their company because the laws were so clear. If the UK stands up and says, we want the fairest marketplace for content providers and for new startup AI companies, I think that's the best way to encourage. Don't give the game to the people who won yesterday. Let people compete on the merits. And the best way to do that is to say you can't leverage the technical advantages that you had yesterday in order to bootstrap a monopoly in the future.
Mm. We talked a bit in preparation about the dynamics between Google and OpenAI in particular. So Google is an important model because companies like OpenAI are also bound by some of the practices of how they gather information, how they end up feeding into this business model.
Yeah, I mean, but I think it's just, it's simpler than that. It's just a fairness argument. Mm. It can't be, you can't win in a business when you have to pay for something and your competitor doesn't. That's where right. You don't get access, but your competitor does because of some legacy relationships. If we want to have a thriving AI marketplace, we have to have a fair set of rules. And the way to make the rules fair is to say that Google has to play by the same as everyone else.